Today we are going to see the design of elastomeric bearings. Since metallic bearings are expensive in cost and maintenance, the recent trend is in favor of the elastomeric bearing. Basically, elastomeric bearings are made up of the elastomer, which is material like a rubber. Sometimes these are reinforced or stiffened by the insertion of steel laminates into it, and these kind of elastomeric bearing we are going to see in today's lecture. Sometimes they may insert a lead core inside the bearing to increase the lateral stiffness. This bearing accommodates rotation as well as the translation through the deformation of elastomer. They are easy to install, low cost, require no maintenance. Also, they do not freeze, corrode or deteriorate. The only probable causes of failure of an elastomeric bearing are inferior material, incorrect design or improper installation. Now, the design of elastomeric bearings. The design value for the bearing we need are the normal load, which comes from the dead weight of superstructure, also the load from the vehicles, that is live load, or the persons walking on the bridge, then attachments like crash barriers, handrails, etc. The horizontal load comes by acceleration or braking of the vehicles, and then improper imposed translation and rotation. All these values are specified in the clause number 916, which is on page number 8 of IRC 83 part 2 1987, which are shown over here. Above values can be determined by suitable analysis of the structure under any critical load combination as specified in IRC 6, which we have already seen while discussing in unit 2. The design, basic design criteria of bearings for design are that it should accommodate the horizontal movement by shearing and rotation by non-uniform linearly varying compressive deformation. The vertical stiffness of bearing should be adequate to avoid significant changes in height by bulging at the sides under vertical compression, and this is ensured by restricting the value of the shape factor S. The shape factor is defined as the ratio of one loaded surface area to the surface area free to bulge for an internal layer of elastomer excluding side cover. The design requires the determination of plan dimensions and thickness of internal layers of elastomer and steel laminates. Basically, this is done by using the table which is given in Appendix 1 of IRC 83 Part 2, 1987, where from the loads which comes by the that maximum load and minimum load by the superstructure on the bearing, we can determine the dimensions of the bearing, which is plan dimension as well as the height of the bearing. Even the number of layers has been also given. Design rules. The dimension of bearing and number of internal layers of elastomer should satisfy the following criteria. The effective area of bearing equal to plan area of laminate should be adequate such that the average normal stress is less than the permissible contact pressure for concrete structure. The ratio of overall length to the breadth is equal or less than 2, which is given in clause number 916.3.3, page number 10 of IRC 83, part 2, 1987. The total elastomer thickness is between 1/5 and 1/10 of the overall breadth of the bearing. All these things they have shown over here.
Translation: the thickness of elastomer in the bearing should be adequate to restrict the shear strain due to horizontal load and horizontal movement due to creep, shrinkage and thermal changes to value less than 0.7. For that, we need to assume the longitudinal translation due to creep, shrinkage and thermal changes can be computed by assuming a total longitudinal strain 5×10⁻⁴ for common reinforced concrete bridges. The shear modulus is assumed as 1 N/mm². Basically, the range has been given in the code, which is 0.8 to 1.2 N/mm². Under the clause 916.3.4, page number 10 of IRC 83, part 2, 1987. The thickness of internal layer of elastomer HI, thickness of laminate HS and the elastomer cover on top and bottom HE are related as below. The table has been shown the values of all these things. Then the side cover of elastomer for steel laminate is 6 mm from all sides. The shape factor is between 6 and 12 and the plan dimension shall confirm R20 series as per IS 10. All these things has been given in clause number 916.3.3, which is over here. Now the rotation. The number of elastomer layers provided shall satisfy the relation, that is alpha should be less than or equals to beta into n into alpha by max, where alpha is the angle of rotation, which may be calculated by using the formula 400 into m max into l divided by E n×10⁻³, which is also given in the code, where the m max is the maximum head span movement, l is the effective span, I is the moment of inertia of superstructure shape, E is the modulus of velocity of material, and n is the number of elastomer layer, where beta is the ratio of the stresses, that is sigma m and divided by sigma m max. Alpha y max, we have the formula, that is 0.5 into sigma m into hi divided by b s square, where the b is the length of bearing along the direction of the span. For calculating sigma m max, sigma m may be taken as 10 MPa. All these things has been given on the page number 10 in clause number 916.3.5. Friction. Under any critical loading, the following limits shall be satisfied to ensure the adequate friction. The shear strain should be less than 0.2 plus 0.1 into sigma m, which is the stress. And the stress value will be between 10 to 2 MPa, which is again given in clause number 916.3.6, page number 11. The total shear stress. The total shear stress due to normal load, horizontal load and rotation should be less than 5 MPa, where the shear stress equals to 1.5 into stress divided by the shape factor. Then shear stress due to horizontal load, assuming the shear modulus as 1 MPa, which is equal to shear strain. And shear stress due to rotation, which is 0.5 into b divided by h s square into alpha bi MPa. All these things has been given in clause number 916.3.7. Then standard plan dimensions and design data as given for the guidelines in IRC 83 are in table in appendix 1, as I have told earlier on page number 23 of IRC 83. which is shown over here. Here you can see the dimensions has been given. Even the area also is given, which we need to choose by using the n max and n minimum values, which is the maximum and minimum load coming under on the bearing. The height of bearing has been specified also, and the n max and n minimum, which is the maximum and minimum permissible number of internal elastomer layers, which is given in the table. So basically, by using this table, we need to choose the dimension. Then we need to take the check of all given above, and hence the design is over.